Антон Павлович Чехов. Overdoing It. Глеб Гаврилович Смирнов, a land surveyor, arrived at the station of Gnilushki. He had another 20 or 30 miles to drive before he'd reach the estate, which he'd been summoned to survey. If the driver weren't drunk and the horses went bad, it would hardly be 20 miles, but if the driver had had a drop and his steeds were worn out, it would mount to a good 40.
Tell me, please, where can I get post horses here?
The surveyor asked of the station gendarme.
What? Post horses? There's no finding a decent dog for 70 miles round, let alone post horses. But where do you want to go anyway?
To Devkina, General Khochotov's estate.
Well, go outside the station. There are sometimes peasants in the yard there. They will take passengers.
The surveyor heaved a sigh and made his way out of the station. There, after prolonged inquiries, conversations and hesitations, he found a very sturdy, sullen-looking, pock-marked peasant wearing a tattered grey smock and bark shoes.
"You've got a queer sort of cart,"
said the surveyor, frowning as he climbed into the cart.
"There's no making out which is the back and which is the front." "What is there to make out? Where the horse's tail is, that's the front, and where your owner is sitting, that's the back."
The little mare was young, but thin, with legs planted wide apart and frayed ears. When the driver stood up and lashed her with a whip made of cord, she merely shook her head. When he swore at her and lashed her once more, the cart squeaked and shivered as though in a fever. After the third lash, the cart gave a lurch. After the fourth, it moved forward.
"Are we going to drive like this all the way?"
asked the surveyor, violently jolted and marveling at the capacity of Russian drivers for combining a slow tortoise-like pace with a jolting that turns the soul inside out.
"We shall get there,"
the peasant reassured him.
"The mare is young and frisky. Only let her get running and there is no stopping her. Now, cursed brute!"
It was dusk by the time the car drove out of the station. On the surveyor's right hand stretched a dark frozen plain, endless and boundless. If you drove over it, you would certainly get into the other side of beyond. On the horizon, where it vanished and melted into the sky, there was the languid glow of a cold autumn sunset. On the left of the road, mounds of some sort, that might be last year's stacks or might be a village, rose up in the gathering darkness. The surveyor couldn't see what was in front, as his whole field of vision on that side was covered by the broad, clumsy back of the driver. The air was still, but it was cold and frosty. "What a wilderness is here," thought the surveyor, trying to cover his ears with the collar of his overcoat. "Neither post nor paddock. If by ill luck one were attacked and robbed, no one would hear you, whatever uproar you made. And the driver is not one you could depend on. And what a huge back! A child of nature like that has only to move one finger, and it would be all up with one. And his ugly face is suspicious and brutal looking."
"Hey, my good man," said the surveyor. "What is your name?" "Mine! Klim!" "Well, Klim, what is it like in your parts here? Not dangerous? Any robbers on the road?" "It's all right. The Lord has spared us. Who should go robbing on the road?" "It's a good thing there are no robbers. But to be ready for anything, I've got 3 revolvers with me," said the surveyor untruthfully. "And it doesn't do to trifle with a revolver, you know. One can manage a dozen robbers."
It had become quite dark. The cart suddenly began creaking, squeaking, shaking, and as though unwillingly turned sharply to the left.
"Where is he taking me to?" the surveyor wondered. "He's been driving straight, and now, all at once, to the left. I shouldn't wonder if he'll take me, the rascal, to some den of thieves. And things like that do happen." "I say, so you tell me it's not dangerous here. That's a pity. I like a fight with robbers. I'm a thin and sickly looking, but I have the strength of a bull. Once three robbers attacked me, and what do you think? I gave one such a dressing that he gave up his soul to God. You understand? And the other two were sent to penal servitude in Siberia. And where I got the strength, I can't say. One grips a strapping fellow of your sort with one hand and wipes him out.
Klim looked round at the surveyor, wrinkled up his whole face and lashed his horse.
Yes, God forbid anyone should tackle me. The robber would have his bones broken. And what's more, he would have to answer for it in the police court too. I know all the judges and the police captains. I'm a man in the government, a man of importance. Here I'm traveling, and the authorities know. They keep a regular watch over me to see no one does me any mischief. There are policemen and village constables stuck behind bushes all along the road.
Stop!
Where have you got to? Where are you taking me to?
Why? Don't you see? It's a forest!
It certainly is a forest, thought the surveyor. I was frightened, but I won't do to betray my feelings. He's noticed already that I'm in a funk. Why is it he's taken to looking round at me so often? He's plotting something for certain. At first he drove like a snail, and now he's dashing along. I say, Klim, why are you making the horse go like that?
I'm not making her go. She's racing along of herself. Once she gets into a run, there is no means of stopping her. It's no pleasure to her that her legs are like that.
You're lying, my man. I see that you're lying. Only I advise you not to drive so fast. Hold your horse in a bit. Do you hear? Hold her in.
What for?
Why? Because four comrades were to drive after me from the station. We must let them catch us up. They promised to overtake us in the forest. It will be more cheerful in their company. They are a strong, sturdy set of fellows, and each of them has got a pistol. Why do you keep looking round and fidgeting as though you were sitting on thorns, huh? Aye, my good fellow. My good fellow, there's no need to look round at me. There's nothing interesting about me, except perhaps the revolvers. Well, if you like, I'll take them out and show you.
The surveyor made a pretense of feeling in his pockets, and at that moment something happened which he couldn't have expected with all his cowardice. Klim suddenly rolled off the cart and ran as fast as he could into the forest.
Take the horse and the cart, you devil! Only don't take my life! Help! Help!
There was a sound of footsteps hurriedly retreating, of twigs snapping, and all was still. The surveyor had not expected such an outcome. He first stopped the horse and then settled himself more comfortably in the cart and fell to thinking. He's run off. He was scared, the fool. Well, what's to be done now? I can't go on alone because I don't know the way. Besides, they might think I've stolen his horse. What's to be done?
Klim! Klim! Klim!
Klim!
Klim!
Klim!
Klim!
Klim!
Klim!
At the thought that he would have to sit through the whole night in the cold and dark forest and hear nothing but the wolves, the echo, and the snorting of the scraggy mare, the surveyor began to have twinges down his spine.
Klimushka! Klimushka!
Klimushka!
Dear fellow!
Dear fellow!
Dear fellow!
Where are you?
Where are you?
Where are you?
Klimushka!
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 For 2 hours the surveyor shouted, and it was only after he was quite husky and had resigned himself to spending the night in the forest that a faint breeze wafted the sound of a moan to him.
Klim, is it you, dear fellow? Let us go on.
You'll murder me.
But I was joking, my dear man. I swear to God I was joking. As though I had revolvers. I told a lie because I was frightened. For goodness sake, let us go on. I'm freezing.
Klim, probably reflecting that a real robber would have vanished long ago with the horse and cart, went up hesitantly to his passenger.
God be with you, sir. If I had known, I wouldn't have taken you for 100 rubles. I almost died of fright.
Klim lashed at the little mare. The cart swayed. Klim lashed once more, and the cart gave a lurch. After the fourth stroke of the whip, when the cart moved forward, the surveyor hid his ears in his collar and sank into thought. The road and Klim no longer seemed dangerous to him.